Testing 1, 2. Testing 1, 2.
Mike. Good evening. Good evening. All right. Let me thank everyone for coming this evening. I know that there are numbers still trying to get in through the registration process. I would encourage you to move forward into the center if you can. But let me just say right off the bat, I am Bob Stewart. I am the director of the Greer-Heard Forum, and we are grateful that you are here this evening. We don't take your presence for granted. We really do appreciate it. This is our 12th year to do the Greer-Heard Forum, and it wouldn't be the success that it is and has been without an interested public. So we're very happy to have you. Let me ask our president here at New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary, Dr. Chuck Kelly, to come lead us in a word of prayer, and then I'll say a few more things and we'll get started.
We do welcome you to the campus of New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary for this event tonight and tomorrow. We're delighted to have you here. New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary is a Southern Baptist seminary, theologically conservative. We believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, the Savior of the world. We believe that everybody who is born has a problem called sin. That is a hindrance, that is a barrier, that is a preventer for a relationship with God, and that only through Christ and Christ alone, as a result of his death on the cross and resurrection from the grave, is salvation and a right relationship with God possible, and an eternity with him in glory secured. We believe that the Bible is God's inspired word, inerrant, infallible. We believe all those things. And about now, if you look down at your program and all that we're doing, you're wondering, why in the world is a school like that hosting an event like this? It is because of two things. Number one, we believe that the search for truth is a good thing. We are confident in that search for truth because we believe that the ultimate end of every serious search for truth is going to end at the feet of Jesus Christ, and we're comfortable with people being along the way in that search. The second reason is very closely tied to that. We believe that a good conversation is always productive. Those are the two philosophical reasons why we're here. The practical reason why we were here is because of a wonderful family, a husband and a wife. She's Greer, he's Heard. And we were talking with them one time, and Mr. Heard had given a great deal of scholarship money to the seminary through the years, and he wanted to do something different and something special. And as we talked with him about what to do, I finally said, well, Mr. Heard, what is it you really want to do? He said, well, I just think Baptist preachers need to learn how to think. And I said, I agree with that. How do you think they can better learn how to think? He said, I think they need to hear from people with a completely different perspective, and they need to learn how to talk about things, even if they don't believe the people that they are talking to. I said, I agree. He said, well, we both agree on that, but the seminary could never do something like that. I said, you're talking about having somebody who's an atheist, a skeptic, an agnostic, very, very liberal, completely different view of the Bible or of God than we have, talking with somebody who's a great evangelical scholar committed to the evangelical faith. He said, yeah, that's the kind of conversation I'm talking about. I said, we would love to do that if you want to make it possible. He said, well, you might, but I know your trustees wouldn't. And I said, well, I'll just ask them. And the trustees unanimously voted that they would love to have that kind of conversation on our campus to give us an opportunity to hear some great minds wrestling with some issues of significance in faith and in the world, talk about those differences and talk about those issues in front of all of us so we could, A, learn about the contours of the discussion, B, learn how to engage in civil conversation with people who are diametrically opposed to things that you may hold dear and precious. And so it was because of a gift from this precious family in order to teach Baptist preachers how to think, who believe that it was always a good thing to have a conversation between people who do not agree with one another. That is why we're here tonight. So we are hoping you will enjoy a good conversation. And I don't care who you are, I promise you're going to hear some things that you don't agree with tonight. Everybody will. And the point is for us to learn how to talk about those differences and how to understand the larger frameworks of important discussions and how different perspectives can interact with one another. We hope it will be a great conversation for you, and we are delighted to have you, whoever you are, whatever particular perspective you may hold, you are welcomed in this place. One very important announcement before I lead us in an opening word of prayer, and that is we are so delighted that our Baptist seminary, conservative though it may be, does believe in indoor plumbing. And so you will be happy to know that there is a men's room over here on my left, your right, and a ladies' room over on your left and my right at the rear of the chapel, should you need those facilities. Once again, we're delighted to have you here. Please join me for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, you opened the great conversation when you walked in the garden with Adam and Eve. And all through your word, we find the conversation continuing. We find that you preserved for all time the words of those who did not accept you, did not believe in you, who were utterly opposed to all that you stand for. We find that through all of time, you preserved in your word dialogue between belief and unbelief, righteousness and unrighteousness. Dialogue at times angry, a dialogue at times heated, dialogue at times very intellectual, dialogue from people of faith struggling with being able to hold on to faith, dialogue at times from people who absolutely opposed all that you are and all that you created us to be. And so, Father, in the shadow of who you are and what you have done with we, your creation, we gather this night for another chapter of the great conversation. We are seekers after truth. Help us to find it. Open our minds, open our hearts, and we pray, O Lord, that you will make yourself plain and clear and connectable to those who are seeking after you. Thank you for these men and women, these scholars who will be leading us in this conversation this weekend, and for the great number of hours and the great devotion they have put into their studies and into their craft that they might make this conversation an interesting conversation. Help all of those who are on this program to enjoy the experience. May it be fruitful for everybody here. In the wonderful name of our Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen and amen.
Thank you, Dr. Kelly. Real quickly, let me make a couple of points and then some introductions. We do have 2 days of the Greer-Heard Forum tonight. We will hear a debate between Bart Ehrman and Michael Bird. But tomorrow we have 4 very good speakers, world-class speakers. We will have Larry, everybody stand up when I call your name, Larry Hurtado from the University of Edinburgh. We'll be speaking in the morning, Dale Martin from Yale University. This is Dale's 4th time back. We just love Dale from Yale. Simon Gathercole from the University of Cambridge, and then Jennifer Wright Knust from Boston University. Each of them will present a full-length paper tomorrow in the morning and afternoon, and we're going to continue it, and we encourage you to come back. Also, I would mention we are recording this as well as live streaming it, and so we will have audio recordings of all of this, and you can get it here at the conference when it's finished. You won't have to wait for it. That will be available in the cafeteria building out here on the quad where our reception will be afterward. And so also, you'll be given a sheet when you leave if you haven't already gotten one. We will have some drawings, and we will give out some very nice door prizes, so you will want to fill that information out and turn it in as well. All right, let me introduce the format and then our speakers, and they will take it away. The format for the evening is that we will open with Bart Ehrman, a 35-minute statement of his position, and then Michael Bird will have a 10-minute response. Then we will have an intermission, coming back after the intermission, Michael Bird will have a 35-minute statement, and Bart will respond for 10 minutes, and then we will open it up for audience Q&A. And I will say more about the Q&A when we get to that point. Then following the Q&A, we will have a reception and book signing. I know the Q&A will not be long enough for everybody to have their answers, questions answered, but I have yet to meet an author who would not answer a question if you brought one of his books to him or her and asked them to sign it. So you have a chance to get further conversation. Let me introduce our speakers for this evening. Bart Ehrman is the James A. Gray Distinguished Professor at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. He has served as both the Director of Graduate Studies and the Chair of the Department of Religious Studies. He is a graduate of Wheaton College, and as such, Professor Ehrman received both his Master's of Divinity and PhD after that from Princeton Theological Seminary. Since then, he has published extensively in the fields of New Testament and early Christianity, having written or edited 29 books, including the best-selling books, How Jesus Became God, The Exaltation of a Jewish Preacher from Galilee, Jesus Interrupted, God's Promise, and Misquoting Jesus. Michael Bird is lecturer in theology at Ridley College in Melbourne, Australia. He is the author of or editor of several books, including the award-winning The Gospel of the Lord, How the Early Church Wrote the Story of Jesus, plus several other volumes, including Jesus is the Christ, The Messianic Testimony of the Gospels, Are You the One Who Is to Come?, The Historical Jesus and the Messianic Question, Evangelical Theology, and recently, How God Became Jesus. Michael lives in Melbourne with his wife and four children, and very much enjoys rugby league, running, cooking, and trying to explain cricket to Americans. So Bart, come and lead us now.
Can you flash up the PowerPoint? New? Yes, thank you very much. Hello. Thank you all for coming out. It's a pleasure being here with you. This will be my third time doing this. I've enjoyed it each time so far. I'm really, really glad to be able to talk with you, and I appreciate the words of the president of the institution, that you welcome other voices, because mine will indeed be a different voice from what one normally hears from this platform. Our talks tonight are about how did Jesus become God. Let me just ask, how many of you would agree that Jesus is God? Right. How many of you would love to see me get creamed? Yeah, right, okay, yeah, good, thanks. And so it goes. Okay, well, at least I know what I'm up against. So let me start by just explaining what I see to be the terms of the question. There is a theological question you could ask, is Jesus God? And almost all of you think that the answer is yes. I will not be disputing that or debating that. I am not going to be talking about whether I think Jesus was God or not, or whether you should think Jesus was God or not. That is a theological question, a question involved with belief in Jesus as a divine being. I'm interested instead in this talk, not in the theological question, but the historical question. My historical question is, when did the followers of Jesus start believing that he was God? And when they started to believe he was God, what did they mean by that? You might think there's only one thing you can mean. If Jesus is God, that just means one thing, right? Wrong. Throughout Christian history, there have been numerous ways that people have understood how Jesus is God. And so saying he's God is the beginning, but it's not the end of the question. as we'll see. I'm actually going to start at the end. This isn't really the end, but it's the end point that I want to pick, rather than the very beginning. The end point I want to pick is a very famous controversy that happened in the fourth Christian century, so about 300 years after Jesus, the so-called Arian controversy. The Arian controversy rose to popular knowledge some years ago when Dan Brown wrote The Da Vinci Code. In The Da Vinci Code, we learn that at the famous Council of Nicaea in the year 325 is when Christians decided that Jesus would be the Son of God. And they took a vote, and it ended up being a close vote. But Jesus ended up winning out, and he became the Son of God. That is in The Da Vinci Code. So I tell my students at Chapel Hill when I'm teaching that if they want to learn about the history of the Middle Ages, the way to do that is not to watch Monty Python and the Holy Grail. And if they want to learn about the history of early Christianity, the way to do that is not by reading Dan Brown. Let me tell you what really happened at the Council of Nicaea with regard to the Arian controversy. There was a influential Christian leader in Alexandria, Egypt, named Arius. Arius developed his theological views in ways that he thought were perfectly orthodox, perfectly true and correct and biblical. His view about Christ was that Christ was God. Christ was a divine being. He was the Son of God and he was God. But how could Christ be God if God was God and there not be two gods? And how can God the Father be almighty and Christ be almighty if they're both almighty, then neither of them is almighty. Only one being can be almighty. And so Arius maintained that in eternity past, God the Father alone existed, but he wasn't the Father yet. God begot a son. God, in effect, brought Christ into being as a second-level divinity, a secondary divinity. He wasn't equal to God. Nobody can be equal with God the Father. He was a secondary-level divinity. There was a time before which Christ did not exist. In other words, Christ came into being at a certain point in time as a secondary divinity. Lower than God the Father. Christ then, through the power of the Father, created the universe. And Christ became a human being to die on the cross. That was Arius's view. This view was a popular view throughout much of Christendom. The basic view had been around for a long time, although Arius formulated it in particularly persuasive ways. And after Arius's day, people continued to hold this view. His bishop in Alexandria was a man named Alexander. Alexander took exception to Arius' view. In Alexander's view, there never was a time when Christ did not exist. Christ had always existed. He wasn't begotten by God at some point in time. He had always been begotten by God. And he wasn't a secondary divinity. He was equal with God the Father. God the Father and God the Son are completely equal in every way, and they always have been forever and ever. That was Alexander's view. There was a big debate about this that led ultimately to the Council of Nicaea in the year 325. A council of bishops from around the world, mainly from the eastern part of Christianity, bishops from around the world who came together to debate the issue. They debated the issue, and they ended up agreeing not with Arius, but with Alexander. That became the standard view that came to be incorporated in the document that is called the Nicene Creed. The Nicene Creed is still recited by people in various Christian denominations today. It was a foundational document that emerged ultimately out of this Council of Nicaea in the year 325. This creed is particularly concerned to define who Christ is. And here are some of the statements from the creed. Jesus Christ is the only Son of God. He's eternally begotten of the Father, not just temporarily at one time, but he's eternally begotten of the Father. He is God from God, light
from light, true God from true God. He's begotten, he's not made, he never came into being, he's always existed, he's begotten, he's not made, and he's of one being with the Father. God the Father and God the Son have the same essence. They are of the same substance. They are co-eternal, co-powerful. They are equal in every way and always have been. This was the view that came out of the Council of Nicaea, when Christ is fully God. So the Council of Nicaea is not when they decided was Jesus going to be the Son of God. Everybody at the Council of Nicaea agreed that Jesus was the Son of God. The question is, in what sense is he the Son of God? And one side won those debates. That's the Council of Nicaea in the year 325. Let's go back to an earlier period, to the earliest gospel that we have that talks about Jesus, to see whether it has a similar view of Jesus or not. The earliest gospel we have in the New Testament is the Gospel of Mark. This is not a debated point. Well, it's always, everything's debatable, but almost nobody debates this. You will not have a Greer-Heard symposium on whether Mark was the first gospel. It was the first gospel. What was Mark's view of Jesus? Mark has a very interesting and compelling view of Jesus. Among other things, Mark certainly thinks that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. Mark's gospel begins by saying that it is the gospel of the Messiah, of Jesus the Messiah, and throughout the gospel, Jesus is called the Son of God. It's very interesting, though, who knows that Jesus is the Son of God in the Gospel of Mark? Now, I'm not talking about what John says or what Luke says or what Matthew says. I'm thinking Mark wrote his gospel, and if somebody read his gospel, what would they think about Jesus? Well, they'd think he was the Son of God. But who in the narrative of Mark knows that Jesus is the Son of God? The interesting thing about Mark, again, this is common knowledge. This is nothing weird to me. And you'll see it yourself if you just read Mark's gospel. The strangest thing about Mark's gospel is that nobody can figure out who Jesus is. Nobody can figure out who he is. The reader knows who he is because Mark tells you he's the Son of God. And you read the gospel, you realize he's doing all these miracles. He's the Son of God. But nobody in the story knows that he's the Son of God. The first eight chapters are all about people not figuring it out. Jesus' family in Mark chapter 3 thinks that Jesus has gone out of his mind, and they come to take him out of the public view. Mark chapter 3, his family, his mother and his brothers and sisters think that he's gone crazy. The people in his hometown can't understand how Jesus can deliver such teachings. Isn't he the carpenter? His four brothers are here with us. His sisters, how does he know all of this? They can't figure out who he is. The Jewish leaders don't know who Jesus is. They don't think he's the Son of God. They think he does miracles because he's possessed by the devil. He has Beelzebub within him. That's why he can cast out demons. And even Jesus' own disciples can't figure out who he is. Chapter 6 of Mark. Mark tells us they did not understand. Chapter 8 of Mark, Jesus asks them, "Do you not yet understand?" No, the answer is the disciples can't figure out who he is. And then comes a key moment in Mark's gospel, halfway through the narrative. Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he asks them, "Who do people say that I am?" And the disciples say, "Well, some say that you're John the Baptist, come back from the dead. Some say you're Elijah, the great prophet, or one of the other prophets." And Jesus says, "Well, who do you say that I am?" And Peter replies, "You are the Messiah." Now, you think, okay, finally, eight chapters in, halfway through the gospel, somebody's figured it out. He's the Messiah. Peter got it right, right? Yeah, kind of. Right after Peter says that, the next verse, Jesus starts teaching that he, the Son of Man, must go to Jerusalem to be rejected by the scribes and elders and be executed, and that in 3 days he'll rise from the dead. And how does Peter respond, the one who just told him he's the Messiah? Peter rebukes him. No, Lord, that's not going to happen to you. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan, for you are thinking of the things of humans, not the things of God. Peter understands that Jesus is the Messiah, but he doesn't understand what that means. He appears to think that Jesus is the Messiah in the sense that Jews would have expected a Messiah to be a great king and warrior who drives out the enemy and sets up God's kingdom in Jerusalem, a powerful figure who will destroy the enemy. And Jesus is saying, the enemy is going to destroy me. Peter doesn't understand that Jesus is the suffering Messiah. Mark's gospel is about how Jesus can be the Messiah if he suffers and dies. For Mark, Jesus has to suffer and die. He is the Messiah because he's the suffering Messiah. This is a long way from the controversy over Arianism. When Jesus says, who do people say that I am? The disciples don't reply, well, some people think that you're equal with the Father and have always existed, and there never was a time before which you did not exist. And, well, some of us actually think that we think the opposite. We think, in fact, you did come into being at some point in the eternity past. That is not the issue. It's nowhere near the issue. It is not discussed in the Gospel of Mark. It's a completely different business. And so my question, how do you get from point A to point B? How do you get from Mark's understanding of Jesus as the Messiah who has to suffer for the sins of the world to Alexander's understanding of Jesus as a person who is co-equal with God, as powerful as God, equal with God in every way, who's existed eternally from eternity past? How do you get from one to the other? Well, I have a thesis about that. Sorry, you can't see thesis very well, but this is a thesis. First, during Jesus' lifetime, his disciples did not believe he was God. That should not be controversial. In Mark, they can't even figure out what kind of Messiah he is, let alone whether he's God or not. The issue, are you God or not, doesn't come up in the Gospel of Mark. During his lifetime, Jesus' followers didn't have any inkling that he was God. But after Jesus' lifetime, his disciples did believe he was God. There's one thing that changed their mind. They came to believe in the resurrection. The resurrection is the absolute key. Why did the followers of Jesus come to believe that he had been raised from the dead? Once again, I'm simply repeating what's in the Bible itself. There are two phenomena that people often point to as evidence for why the disciples thought Jesus was raised from the dead. The first is that there was an empty tomb. 3 days after Jesus died, the tomb was empty. It's true in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the tomb is empty. It is false that anybody believes because of it. People today might be convinced that if the tomb is empty, Jesus must have been raised from the dead. But nobody in the New Testament comes to believe Jesus was raised from the dead based on the empty tomb. Think about the Gospel of John. Mary goes to the tomb, finds it empty, and what does she conclude? Somebody stole his body. That's exactly what you would think. If somebody was buried in a tomb and you went there 3 days later and it was empty, you wouldn't think resurrection. No, you'd think grave robbers. Or you'd think, hey, I'm at the wrong tomb. Or the empty tomb isn't going to convince anybody and didn't convince anybody. What convinced people is that Jesus appeared to people. Is the appearance of Jesus alive again after his death that convinced people he had been raised from the dead? There are several people who almost certainly claim to see Jesus alive afterwards. Historically, I think really these people really did claim that they saw Jesus alive afterwards. Peter figures prominently in these narratives as the one who saw Jesus. According to Paul, he was the first to see Jesus after his death. Paul himself says that he had a vision of Jesus. He's unambiguous about it. In the Gospels, it's Mary who goes to the tomb and sees that Jesus and learns that he's been raised from the dead and then sees him. And so there it is, Peter, Paul, and Mary. What did these people conclude once they came to think that Jesus was raised from the dead? Well, it's a very interesting question. Suppose we're not living in the 21st century, but we're living in the first century. What do we think in the first century if we think that a person has been exalted to heaven? Now, when the early Christians came to believe that Jesus was raised from the dead, they didn't think that it was a near-death experience and that, like, he never really died and it just seemed like he died the way we have near-death experiences. They thought that Jesus had been raised from the dead, and it wasn't that his body came back to life for another 20 years. It's not that he's going to die again. He's going to live forever. He has been taken up to heaven, and he's seated at the right hand of God Almighty. What did people in the ancient world think about somebody who, after their death, had been taken up to heaven? It's quite clear what ancient people thought about that, because we have numerous indications about what ancient people thought about that. The Romans believed that the founder of the city of Rome, Romulus, had been taken up to heaven at his death. There's a story about it in the Roman historian Livy. Romulus, who has founded the city, and the city's going strong, the Senate is in place, they've got a functioning army. Romulus and the senators are sitting next to each other on a platform like this, and the army is marching in front of them as a parade. A thunderstorm comes up, we're told in Livy, and it grows dark, and a fog comes, and when the fog lifts, Romulus isn't there anymore. He's not on his throne. What happened to him? What they said happened to him is that he got taken up to heaven. And at that point, they started worshiping him as a god. He became the god Quirinus, who was one of the three main deities, one of the three main gods for ancient Rome. This was Romulus, the man, taken up to heaven, became a god. Not just in Roman circles, but in Jewish circles. There were Jewish thinkers at the time of the New Testament who thought that Moses had been taken up into heaven at his death and had become a god. We have clear evidence of this from Philo, the Jewish philosopher who taught in Alexandria, Egypt. Philo wrote several books about Moses, in one of which he says that when he died, he was taken up into heaven and he became a divine being. He became a god-like figure. Not just pagans, but also Jews thought an exalted figure who went up to heaven when he died became a god. Jesus was thought to have been a person who went up to heaven. What are the followers of Jesus supposed to think if Jesus has gone up to heaven? Well, they think what anybody would think. They think that he had been made a divine being. And so the earliest Christological views, in other words, the earliest views of who Christ was, our views that at the resurrection, God made Jesus a divine being. It was at the resurrection that Jesus became a divine being. It's at the resurrection that Jesus became the Son of God. Again, this isn't just something that I've made up. You can find it in your Bibles. There's a speech of Paul in the book of Acts, chapter 13, verses 32 through 33. This is what Paul says. The promises God made to our forefathers, he has now fulfilled to us, their children, by raising Jesus from the dead. As it is written in the second Psalm, you are my son, today I have begotten you. By raising Jesus from the dead, he's fulfilled the promises because of the scripture that says, you are my son, today I have begotten you. What is the today? It's the day of the resurrection. That's when God made Jesus the Son of God. Or as Peter says in Acts chapter 2, verse 36, that at his resurrection, God made him both Lord and Christ. The earliest followers of Jesus thought that it was at the resurrection that God made Jesus into a divine being. Now again, I'm not saying that I think that you should believe that, you should have that view. I'm not saying you should reject that view. I'm saying this was the earliest Christian view. This is sometimes called an adoptionistic Christology, the idea that God adopted Jesus to be his son. When we hear about adoption today, we sometimes don't treat adopted people the way we should, or we don't think about them quite right. We think, you know, an adopted child is not quite, you know, it's not quite the same as a blood child. In the ancient world, it was the adopted child who was superior to the blood child. Julius Caesar had two sons. One of them was a son by blood, a son he had with Cleopatra. You've probably never heard of him. His name was Caesarion. He had a second son that wasn't a blood son. It was his adopted son, the one he adopted to be his heir. You've probably heard of him. He was Caesar Augustus, the most powerful figure in the ancient world. The adopted son was the one that mattered. In this view of things, God adopted Christ to be his son, which means he made him his heir. He gave him all of his power and his authority and his prestige. This is an amazing view of things. And it's the view the earliest Christians had of Jesus, that at his resurrection, God had adopted him. There's a very famous scholar of the 20th century, New Testament scholar, whom some of you may have known. If you're in seminary, you certainly know him, Raymond Brown, one of the great New Testament interpreters of the second half of the 20th century. Raymond Brown had a view that I think is very persuasive, that the Christians, as they thought more and more about how Christ had been adopted to be God, how he had been exalted to a divine status, how they pushed the moment at which that exaltation had happened backwards. They started out, when they believed in the resurrection, thinking, God has made Jesus his son at the resurrection. But they thought about it for a little while longer, and they thought, you know, surely Christ was the Son of God, not just at his resurrection. He must have been the Son of God for his entire ministry. And so they started telling stories about his baptism. Jesus gets baptized. He comes up out of the water. The heavens split open. The Spirit of God descends upon him, and a voice comes from heaven. In Luke's gospel, what does the voice say? You are my son, today I have begotten you. It's at the baptism that Jesus... So he was the Son of God for his entire ministry. People started thinking about it more, and they said, you know, actually, he must have been the Son of God for his entire life, not just starting with his baptism. And so they pushed it back further to his birth. Now, in Mark's gospel, Jesus starts at his baptism, and he hears the voice from heaven. There's no birth of Jesus in Mark. There is a birth of Jesus in Matthew and Luke, and it's a remarkable story. As you all know, Jesus' mother is a virgin. Why is she a virgin? Because God is his father. Jesus becomes the Son of God at his birth, as the angel Gabriel tells Mary in Luke chapter 1. He tells her that she's going to bear a son, and she says, I've never known a man. How will I have a son? And he says, the power of the Most High will come upon you. The Holy Spirit will overshadow you. The one who is born of you will therefore be called the Son of God. He'll be called the Son of God because God is literally his father. For Luke, Jesus then, originally thought of the Son of God at his resurrection, then at his baptism, then at his birth, and then they thought more about it, and they pushed it back even farther. Jesus must have been the Son of God from eternity past. If you read Matthew and Luke carefully, where you read about the virgin birth story, there is no hint that Jesus existed before the virgin birth in Matthew and Luke. Read them carefully. In Matthew and Luke, it's not that a pre-existent divine being, the Christ, had become incarnate through the Virgin Mary. Jesus comes into existence with the Virgin Mary when God makes her pregnant in Matthew and Luke. But as people thought about it more, they thought he must have been the Son of God from eternity past, and so they started developing a different view, a view which is not an exaltation view, not a view where a human becomes a divine being. They started developing a view of incarnation. The word incarnation means something like having come in the flesh. An incarnation view is the view that Christ came into the world having existed before in the heavenly realm. Christ was a divine being who became a human being. This is not the view of Mark. It's not the view of Matthew or Luke. It is the view of the Gospel of John. In the Gospel of John, Christ is not born of a virgin in John. In the Gospel of John, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him. And apart from him, nothing came into being that came into being. In him was life, and his life was the light of humans. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The Word become flesh is Jesus Christ. The Gospel of John understands that Christ was a pre-existent divine being who became a human being. That's an incarnation Christology, as opposed to the exaltation Christology you get in other early Christians. Once Christians started thinking more widely that Jesus had been a pre-existent divine being, they started debating in what sense was he a divine being? And if he was a divine being, how is he a human being? Or was he a human being? And if he's a divine being and God's a divine being, you have two divine beings, don't you have two gods? Or do you have only one God? No, we have one God. Is Jesus God? Yes. Is God the Father God? Yes. So you've got two gods. No, we have one God. And so the debates continued. There were people who thought that, in fact, Christ was God because he was fully God. He was God who appeared to be a human being. God can't really be a human being any more than a human being can really be a rock. These are different things. So a view called docetism comes from a Greek word, dokeo, which means to seem or to appear. There were Christians in the second and third Christian centuries who said Christ was God and he only seemed to be a human. He only looked like him. I've got to say, most of my students probably think this. I think most of my students think that Christ, since Christ was God, he couldn't really be a human being. And so he was fully omnipotent and omniscient as an infant. So, you know, as a two-week-year-old, Jesus could have spoken Swahili if he wanted to. Because he's God. He can do anything, right? Well, this view lost out. Because Christian theologians said if Christ wasn't human, he couldn't die for the sins of the world. If he didn't really have blood, he couldn't shed his blood. Salvation requires that he not only be divine, but he also be human. And so this docetic view lost out. There are other Christians who wanted to say in the second and third Christian century, so I'm talking about 100, 200 years after the Gospels, before Arius, there were Christians who said, actually, Christ is both human and divine, but it's because of this. There was a man, Jesus, who was a very righteous man, who at some point in his life, say his baptism, was entered into by a divine being from heaven. Christ was a divine being who entered into the man, Jesus, so that Jesus Christ is both human and divine because he has a human part and he has a divine part. And so there's two of him. And then when the man Jesus died, the Christ went up to heaven. I call this a separationist view because it separates between Jesus and the Christ. That was another view. That was declared a heresy because if Jesus isn't completely human, and if he isn't completely God at one and the same time, then you're not dealing with one person, you're dealing with two persons. But Jesus Christ is one person, not two persons. God is one and Christ is one. The church is one, there's one faith, one Lord, one baptism, there's one, there's not two. This view ended up losing. A more interesting view, in some ways, is a view that scholars have called modalism. This, for a long time, was the standard view in Christianity. Even its opponents said most people held to this view. Even the leaders of the Church of Rome held to this view at the end of the second century. It's called modalism because it says that God exists in three modes. Now, just like I myself, Bart Ehrman, just like I myself personally, I am at one and the same time, I am the son to my father, I'm the brother to my sister, and I'm the father to my children. I am a son, a brother, and a father at the same time. And God's like that. God is three persons, Father, Son, and Spirit, but there's only one of him. There's not three of him. I'm not three different persons. I'm one person. I'm Son, Brother, Father. God is three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So this is a view called modalism because God exists in three modes of existence. This view ended up losing out too, even though it was very popular a long time, and possibly people today still hold some view like this, but it ended up losing out. It ended up losing out because surely the Father and the Son are different from one another. If you're the father of a son, you can't be the son that you're the father of. They have to be different. And, you know, when Jesus was on earth, he sometimes would pray to God the Father. He wasn't just talking to himself. And so this view ended up being seen as problematic as well. This modalist view was popular in Rome especially, and was the view of the bishops of Rome, the people who would have later become the Pope. And eventually then it was turned back by people who held to a different view, the Trinity. It was in the context of arguing about modalism that one of the church fathers, a man named Tertullian, devised the term Trinity. The Trinity refers to the three persons who are separate persons, individual persons, who are all God. Now, I should say that Arius held to a doctrine of the Trinity. Arius believed in the God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but he thought the Son and the Holy Spirit were inferior to God the Father, because you can't have two things that are almighty, because if two things are almighty, neither one of them is almighty. They share might. And so only one can be almighty. But, and by the way, that was the view of Tertullian too, who devised the term Trinity. He thought that the Son was subordinate to God the Father. But eventually, this view went away. Eventually, this view was superseded by the view that there is a Trinity of three beings who are all God. They're equally God. They're equally powerful, equally all-knowledgeable, equally eternal. They've all existed forever. There are three of them, Father, Son, and Spirit. And yet there's only one God. There's one God manifest in three persons. Well, but if you got three of them, there are three gods, right? No, there's only one. Okay, if there's one, then there's not three, right? No, there are three. Well, that doesn't make any sense. Right. If it made any sense, it wouldn't be a mystery. The Trinity is a mystery, which means you cannot understand it. And if you think you understand it, you misunderstand it. This became the traditional view of Christianity. All four of these views, docetism, separationism, modalism, and the Trinity, all four of those are logical outworkings of the view that Christ is God while God is God. They have different logics that are driving them, but all four of them are logical. They all make sense. It's just one of those views ended up becoming the Orthodox view, that there are three persons, all of whom are God. My point is, the early Christians did not think this. You will not find this doctrine in the New Testament. This doctrine is a later doctrine that developed out of earlier views. The earliest Christians came to believe that Jesus had been exalted to God's right hand at his resurrection, and they thought that therefore God had made him a divine being. 300 years later, they were saying that Jesus had always existed, that he was co-eternal with the Father, he was co-omniscient with the Father, and that he, in fact, was God Almighty himself, the creator of all things. Thank you very much.
G'day. Yes, I will use that charming Aussie accent to win over my audience. Out of curiosity, who wants to see me get creamed? Anyone? Yes, we do have. Yeah, and Bart as well. But I thought all you Americans love Australians. We invented Crocodile Dundee. And the Outback Steakhouse. Without us, there's no Outback Bowl. Well, thank you very much, Bart. That was a great lecture because it shows some of the issues that are involved when you talk about the early church's beliefs about Jesus. How there was debates, there was genuine development as to what happened. And there is a story being told here, of people struggling to find the grammar, the language, and the frameworks to express who is Jesus. And it seems very clear to me, and I'm sure just to Bart, that it wasn't all worked out in the first few seconds. Nonetheless, Bart's precise narration of that story, there are a few points I really would like to tweak a bit. Let's go to his reading of the Gospel of Mark. And here I think Bart is correct. The Gospel of Mark is largely, I would call, an apology for a crucified Messiah. That's the main purpose of Mark. Mark is dealing with the issue of, well, how can he be the Messiah if he's crucified? And Mark is arguing that he's not the Messiah despite the cross, but precisely because of it. Because that's where we see him undertaking his messianic vocation. There we see him combining in himself the roles of the suffering servant, the kingship language we find in the Psalms, various views of the Messiah, and that kind of a thing. However, one thing that emerges in the Gospel of Mark is that he's not merely a human Messiah. I don't think he's even a figure who has been made divine or adopted to divine sonship at his baptism. I'll explain more of that in my talk later on. But for now, what I want to say is I think there might be a little bit more going in Mark's Gospel than that. For example, you pointed out, Bart, that in the first half of Mark's Gospel, nobody knows who he is. But there are some beings who know who he is. The demons know who he is. When Jesus rocks up, they say, "We know who you are, the Holy One of God." But the question that I have in my mind is, and hopefully Simon will answer this, how do they know that? Is there kind of like a demonic version of Twitter? You know, watch out. Watch out for the crazy Galilean guy with a beard. He is whooping our butt something fierce. How do they know who he is? How do they know he's come to destroy them? And certainly when we get to the end of the Mark's Gospel at the trial scene, there is this incredible moment where Caiaphas finally asks Mark who he is. And so, look, are you the son of the Blessed One or what? And Jesus responds in language which combines Daniel 7:13, Psalm 110, and those two texts have one common theme, and that is someone being enthroned beside the Lord Yahweh. So that's a very interesting thing. And that then creates this ambiguity that Jesus is somehow identified with the Israel's Kurios, Israel's Lord. That's something we see in the narrative. So I mostly agree with what Bart is saying, but I think there's some extra details we need to consider in the story. The other thing Bart brings up is pointing out how the exaltation of Jesus has an affinity with the exaltation of other figures from antiquity, like Romulus and Moses, according to Philo. And again, this is perfectly true. One thing I tell my students is you cannot understand how Christianity is different from Greco-Roman religion until you first understand how they are similar. And there are genuine analogies and similarities. Certainly, if you read a passage like Acts 13:33-34, there is exaltation language. This man, Jesus, has been exalted to divine status. The question is that all they believed? Was that the limits of their belief? Do they compact everything around that they believe nothing more? That's the bit I'm not so sure about. The other thing I would have to say is I'm not convinced that belief in the resurrection alone would make Jesus divine. I mean, if one of the other poor chaps who was crucified with Jesus was believed to have been raised from the dead, would they have worshipped him? Would they have concluded that he was enthroned with Yahweh? We should now use the language of Isaiah 45 to describe him, that he held the life of power, held life and power, redemption, the majesty of God in his hands. I don't think so. Because we know of stories where people were believed to have died and gone to heaven, but they were never worshipped as divine. A good example is the testament of Job. Job's children die under a horrible earthquake. They go looking for the bodies. They can't find him. They don't infer resurrection, but they say they've been assumed to heaven. But they don't start worshipping them or offering prayers or that sort of thing to them. So they had gone to recline at the bosom of Abraham. You know, rock my soul in the bosom. bosom of Abraham, something like that, but they're not thereby divine. Similarly, in the Testament of Abel, I think it's Abel who dies. He goes to heaven and he becomes like the angels. He has a heavenly transcendent status, but he's not worshipped or regarded as God. I would also contest probably your reading of Philo on Moses' part. It is true. Philo says Moses becomes God, but he makes the emphasis he is God to Israel. He has God-like power over Israel. In fact, Philo goes out of his way to specify that he is not God in the same way like the Father. Because Moses does not have control over nature the same way Israel's God did. So he has God-like power and status over Israel, but he doesn't seem to be exalted in the same sense that the Father is. The second last thing I would add is Raymond Brown was a great scholar. I really like him. I've learned a lot from his works. But he's not the only show playing in town. There's another great critical scholar I like called John Knox. And I mean not the Scottish reformer. I mean a scholar from the mid-20th century. He argues that Jesus' pre-existence is what the disciples inferred from his resurrection. So he doesn't think it was something that developed later. He thinks pre-existence is something that they inferred on the resurrection. Because if Jesus has ascended into heaven, then in retrospect, he must have descended down in the first place. That could be the type of logic that is being employed. The final thing I'll say, I think Bart is completely right. The views of the Trinity did develop. They were contentious. The question was, whose way of telling the story is the most compelling and the most coherent? What explains both the biblical texts, but what is it as well explains their experiences? And if you go through the text, then that really is the question, which is the best way of putting it? I mean, if you read the baptism story as a modalist, as Bart pointed out, it's ridiculous. It becomes a moment of divine ventriloquism. You know, it's Jesus talking to, doing the own voice from heaven. Might be a good vaudeville show, but it doesn't make good Christology. Similarly, if you take the Great Commission in the Gospel of Matthew, therefore baptize them in what has to go in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. No one, though, would it baptize in the name of a deity, a creature, and an impersonal force. It wouldn't make a lot of sense to do that. So the question was, which view had the most coherence and the best value at explaining their scripture and their experience? And Bart is correct that views of the Trinity developed from earlier views, but those other views, I think, were done in dialogue with scripture. And it was about finding the best way of framing debate. Now, yes, Arians, Modalists, Docetists, they all looked to Scripture for their answer, but the one view that did win over the majority in the end was the Orthodox view. They said, despite whatever problems it has, it seems to be the way that's got the most going for it as for explaining the text and our experience and what we've learned. And I think I can finish there and hand over to Bart. All right, do I hand back over to Bart or... Oh, back to you, Bob.
Man, I wish I had an accent like that. All right, we're going to take an intermission, and we probably need a biblical number, but 3 is not enough, and 40 is too many. And so let's get dispensational and take a 7. Take 7. Okay. All right, everybody, come back to get back in your seats. Zit and Z. Okay, if you don't get back in your seats, I'm going to start singing. And that will not be a pretty sound. All right. While you're getting back in your places, we're going to give them 2 minutes. Okay, my boss has said 2 minutes. We do want to remind you that that this is a theological seminary, and we have theological degrees, and they are rolling by on the screen. In particular, we have one new degree, the Master of Arts in Christian Apologetics, which is a 36-hour degree. You don't have to have any previous theological education to do that. If you happen to have a Master of Divinity, you can actually, you've already earned about half of it. So you might want to see me or one of our people at the Greer-Heard CD table and so forth. And did I mention we're selling CDs? Okay. All right. All right. Well, Michael Bird is going to come now and speak to us for a period of up to 35 minutes. These would be American minutes. And then Bart will have up to 10 minutes to respond, and we'll do some Q&A.
Minutes. Okay. Okay, we get the screenshot going, do we? Or do I control it? Loading. Awkward. Mine's easy to fly.
You don't want to use Bart's PowerPoint, do you?
I could just get the same lecture again, but then I could charge him royalties or something. I don't know. Ah, ka-ching. There we are. Okay. Well, it's a pleasure to be invited back to the Greer-Heard Forum. I take that as a fact that the last time I was here means it went, you know, pretty well then. It's kind of like when you get a second date. You know, it's a good feeling when you're invited to come back. I'm learning to love New Orleans, by the way. It's a great city. It's a lot of fun things to do here, and New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary is definitely a great place. I'd like to acknowledge the sponsors of this event, the Greer-Heard family, President Chuck Kelly for hosting it, Bob Stewart and his team who organized this, and they are great. They show us such wonderful hospitality, and they've done some great work in putting this on. I have to confess I'm lucky enough to be sharing this platform with a great number of scholars. Bart, who we've just heard, and you can tell why it's fairly obvious that he is a best-selling author and much in demand as a speaker about things related to Christian origins. But I'm also here with some others. Tomorrow we're going to hear from Dale Martin and Jennifer. They are likewise two outstanding scholars. Now, I don't know Jennifer as well. Where is Jennifer? Right in front of me. But I've got to know her a little bit in these events. But I've met Dale several times. And you'll certainly be stimulated and challenged by what they have to say. In addition, we have two other scholars who I know from my time in the UK, Larry Hurtado. And I have to say that Larry is what I would call the Guru, Swami, Ninja, Jedi Master, SEAL Team 6 Commander of all things about early church Christology. And yes, Larry, you can put that on your CV. Not to be outdone either is Simon Gathercole, who's from some upstart college called Cambridge University. But Simon has written on topics like the Synoptic Gospels, the Apostle Paul, and the non-canonical Gospels. Larry and Simon are both scholars of incredible academic stature and physical stature. I mean, standing next to them, I feel like a hobbit. I feel like saying to Simon, hey, Gandalf, is it time for elevensies? So I'm honored to be in such illustrious company with these fine scholars. The theme of this forum is how did Jesus become God, which pertains to mapping the origins of belief in Jesus' divinity. And, you know, look, there are a number of topics that we could cover. We could talk about, you know, what did Jesus think about himself? We could talk about the evangelists or the Apostle Paul, the post-70 developments, the second and third centuries, and so forth. But let me tell you what I'm not going to argue. I'm not going to argue that Jesus kind of cruised around saying, hi, I'm God, second person of the Trinity. I'm going to die for your sins soon, and then I'd like you all to worship me. I'm not going to argue anything like that. Or argue that the early church basically downloaded the Nicene theology app 10 seconds after the resurrection. There was diversity in the early church. There was definitely a development of theology that took place. It's as if something momentous happened and the next 400 years was based around who the heck was that guy. That is largely what was driving theology. But of all of the topics that have been discussed, there is one I want to examine with a close inspection. You see, a common line in scholarship has been that the earliest view of Jesus in circulation was that Jesus was a man adopted either at his resurrection or at his baptism, where he then became the Son of God. Now, Bart has thankfully already touched upon this. Now, this is called adoptionist Christology. In adoptionism, there was a time when Jesus was not the Son of God. Divine sonship is not something that Jesus possessed for all time, but something he acquired in the course of his life. Adoptionism is thought to be the first Christology. But that's not the end of it, though, because we know that views of Jesus eventually changed and evolved into a belief about the incarnation, that Jesus was the God of Israel made flesh. And that meant that the early adoptionism could be relegated to the status of a heresy. And even though it was relegated to a kind of heretical status, even then it didn't die out. It was propagated by groups like the Ebionites, a Jewish Christian sect, Theodotus, a lay Christian cobbler in Rome at the end of the second century, and Paul of Samosata, a bishop of Antioch in the third century. For example, note this. James Dunn says that the Ebionites, this Jewish Christian group, held to an adoptionist Christology, and he contends that this heretical Jewish Christianity would appear to be not very different from the faith of the first Jewish believers. Now, Bart has argued fairly similarly to that, asking, you know, if we were to get one of the evangelists, one of the followers of Jesus to write a gospel of Jesus within a year of his resurrection, you would find an exaltation Christology, not one of incarnation or pre-existence. It would be a Christology where Jesus became the Son of God when God worked his greatest miracle on him, raising him from the dead and adopting him as his son by exalting him to his right hand and bestowing upon him his own very power, prestige, and status. So that's Bart's words there. That would mean, rather than in the beginning was the Word and the Word was with God, you'd get something like in the beginning was a mere man who was adopted as God's son at the resurrection. Now, my response to that thesis, to quote George Gershwin, is it ain't necessarily so. I cannot prove that an adoptionist Christology did not exist amongst any of his followers in the early decades of the first century, okay? Or the early decades after the resurrection. I can't prove that. What I think I can show is that the standard texts and the normal groups attributed with an adoptionist Christology do not in fact say that or did not in fact hold that. So what I'm going to do is look at a number of these texts and discuss a number of these groups, and I'm going to try show that they did not exhibit adoptionist Christologies. So let's start off with the first one. That's probably a bit detailed, isn't it? I can see it up there. Romans 1, this is where Paul is writing to the church in Rome, and at the head of this letter, this is what he writes. He talks about the gospel concerning his son, who is descended from David according to the flesh, and was declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, Romans 1, 3 to 4 is probably a short creedal formula that was used in the early church, that was in circulation, and Paul is most likely using it because it's known to him and to his Roman audience. So he kind of cites it to show that they're both singing off the same sheet of gospel music. Now, what Bart, and he's not alone in this, what he says about this text is, from this creed, one can see that Jesus is not simply the human Messiah. He is not simply the Son of God Almighty. He is both things in two phases. First, he is the Davidic Messiah predicted in Scripture. And second, he is the exalted divine Son. So Jesus goes from being the human Messiah, then with resurrection, he becomes the divine Son of God. Now, Paul may have wanted to embellish that further because it did not fit with his own view, which included pre-existence. Yet for the original framers of this creed, Jesus was a Messiah from the house of David during his earthly life, but at the resurrection, he was made something more than that. The resurrection was Jesus' exaltation to divinity. I think there are three problems with this view. Number one, I don't think resurrection necessarily makes you a divine son of God. For a start, son of God in the Jewish world does not usually mean a human person who's lived a meritorious life and received divine sonship after a bodily resurrection. We do know of figures who were exalted to heaven, who were taken up. Figures like Enoch and Elijah, they were thought to be assumed into heaven, but they were not thereafter called a son of God. I mean, think of other examples. Lazarus was raised from the dead. That didn't make him a son of God. The two witnesses in the book of Revelation, they come back to life, but they're not treated as sons of God. So, and you do get these exalted figures like Moses and others treated, but there always seems to be a certain degree of divine honor given to them, but not on the absolute sense that's normally attributed to Yahweh. I also find it interesting that scholars frequently want to find a parallel between Jesus being made divine in his resurrection and the imperial cult. You know, so the idea when a Roman emperor dies, he becomes a god, that sort of a thing. And what I find interesting is when the Roman emperor dies, he never becomes a son of God. He becomes the deified one. He becomes a deus. It's the guy left behind, the heir, who is still very much alive. He becomes the Son of God. It's the adopted son still on earth. He's the one who now can have this title, Son of the Divine Augustus. Roman emperors don't die and become sons of God. It's the heirs who are left behind. Second, the other thing we've got to remember is that the titles Son of David and Son of God were both designations for Israel's Messiah. Now, that's rooted in the Old Testament, where we find the promise that one of David's descendants will be God's own son. That's 2 Samuel chapter 7. We see Israel's king ritually celebrated as a divine son in places such as Psalm 2 and Psalm 72. And there's a similar phenomena in Jewish intertestamental literature, which looks forward to a coming son of David, the Messiah, who's often called the Son of God. That's in the Psalms of Solomon, in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And Son of David and Son of God are frequently put together in the New Testament. So if the Son of David, the Messiah, is a son of God, then we cannot say that divine sonship begins at a later point like resurrection. That's because in the creed we're examining, Jesus already is the Son of God because he is the divine, the descendant of David. He is the messianic son. That's what makes him the Son of God. So there is a change in status, not from mere human to Son of God, but from being a Davidic son of God to being an exalted son of God, a son of God in power and majesty and that sort of thing. Third, in order to read this text as adoptionistic, one has to assume that Paul himself added the phrase in power to this creed in order to mitigate its adoptionist content. The underlying assumption is that the creed in its current form is not adoptionistic, but before that it was. So you had a creed that was adoptionistic, and then to mitigate that, to cleanse it of this adoptionistic traits, Paul has added the phrase in power, which completely changes the sense, so it's no longer adoptionistic. In other words, that would mean Paul took over an adoptionistic text and made it non-adoptionistic. Now, while I think Paul is working with some traditional materials he's inherited, we don't know. We don't know what he added, what he expanded, what he abbreviated. We simply do not know. And to assume that Paul must have added this phrase in order to make it more palatable to his own theology, that he has transformed an adoptionistic creed into something non-adoptionistic, that's a pretty thin branch to hoist a heavy argument. I rather like what Simon Gathercole says in our book. He says, if you base your argument on a conjecture, like in power was added, then really your whole argument then becomes a conjecture. So like a good many other scholars, I don't see any real proof that Paul added the phrase in power, turning this adoptionistic creed into a non-adoptionistic one. So, to sum that bit up, being raised to life doesn't make you the Son of God. Yes, it could make you immortal, it could make you heavenly, you could be equal to the angels, you could recline in the bosom of Abraham. Doesn't make you a Son of God. The creed does envisage a two-stage movement, but that movement's not from being a human Messiah to the Son of God in power. It is a movement from being the Davidic Son of God to being the Son of God in power and majesty and the like. And if the adoptionistic reading is to work, it requires that the phrase in power is an addition, and there is no evidence for that beyond the mere assertion itself. Let's look at our second text. This is from the Gospel of Mark. And I think Bart touched upon this. And Mark says, and it happened in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized in the Jordan by John. And immediately as Jesus was rising up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven and said, you are my beloved Son, in you I am well pleased. As Bart wonderfully pointed out, the Gospel of Mark is often regarded as something of an innovation in the chronology of when and how Jesus became the Son of God. As Bart explained, there was a tendency in the tradition to project Jesus' sonship earlier and earlier. And Mark represents that phase where it's being projected from the resurrection down to his baptism. And scholars place Mark within this evolving process of where divine sonship is being put gradually earlier and earlier. And the Gospel of Mark, so it goes, has no Christology of pre-existence, so Jesus then would become the Son of God at his baptism. So Jesus would be divine in the sense that he is adopted to be God's Son at his baptism, not the resurrection. Now let me add something on this. If you are a Roman reader, and if you're reading the Gospel of Mark for the first time, I certainly think it is possible you could take it in that sense. Because if you know about the deifications in Rome of Julius Caesar, Augustus, and Claudius and the like, you could think that we're, and this is where adoption was practiced in Rome. I think someone could, in their own fashion, in light of their own experiences, they could take it that way. I just don't think Mark intends us to take it that way. First, Jesus' adoption is not regarded as the reward for his virtuous life. That was largely what was argued by a later number of authors in the second century, that Jesus was a virtuous man who earned, warranted, or merited divine adoption or exaltation or something like that. If that is what Mark intended, you would expect Mark, like those later exaltationists, to employ something similar. What I think Mark is doing is he's not presenting the baptism as the beginning of Jesus, rather he sees it as the beginning of the gospel. So the baptism story is not the beginning of Jesus, it's the beginning of the gospel about Jesus. Second, the other thing we've got to remember is that there are other points in the Gospel of Mark where Jesus is called a divine son by another voice, particularly at the transfiguration scene in Mark 9 and at the crucifixion scene in Mark 10. Mark envisages three Christologically decisive moments in Jesus' career, and no one of them is singularly determinative for Jesus' sonship. If a voice pronouncing Jesus as a son implies adoption, it would mean Jesus gets adopted three times. Once at his baptism, again at the crucifixion, at transfiguration, and then again at the crucifixion scene. In fact, if I wanted to have an adoptionist reading of Mark, I would be more inclined to say he gets adopted at the crucifixion, because that is where he dies. Then he could experience some kind of apotheosis and deification, and it's a Roman soldier who announces him to be a son of God. If you wanted to have an adoption scene in Mark, I think it would be more likely, more logical to have it at the crucifixion scene rather than at the baptism. I think Mark treats the baptism, the transfiguration, and the crucifixion not as moments of adoption, but divine moments of revelation, as clarifications as to who Jesus is. Third, Mark's overall Christology creates a certain tension. On the one hand, Jesus is fully and authentically human. Jesus in the Gospel of Mark is a good monotheist. He proclaims the kingdom of God. He prays to God. He says no one is good but God alone. And yet, there are other passages and actions that make it look as if Jesus is somehow paradoxically, ambiguously to be identified with the Lord, with the Kurios. Now, I do think Mark does intimate Jesus' pre-existence. Simon Gathercole will hopefully have more to say on that tomorrow. No? Oh, well, read his book. It's cracking good read. You know, I'm thinking of things like how Jesus seems to belong to the heavenly council. He transcends the heaven-earth divide. The demons seem to know who he is. I think that's implied. What I can say a little bit more confidently is that in the Gospel of Mark, Israel's Lord is split between God and Jesus. Oh, and it's that way from the very beginning of the Gospel. The opening of the Gospel has John declaring that preparing the way for the Lord, the coming Lord, and the one who comes is none other than Jesus. Similarly, when Jesus debates with the scribes as to whether the Messiah is a son of David, Jesus quotes Psalm 110 at them, to the effect that the Messiah will be more than an earthly son of David, one who has his throne established by Yahweh. Similarly, at the trial scene, when he asked if he is the son of the Blessed One by Caiaphas, Jesus responds with a combination of Daniel 7:13 and Psalm 110, to the effect that he will share in the lordship of Israel's God. The net effect of sharing Yahweh's throne is that Jesus stands in a relation of near equality with God, to use the language of Joel Marcus. The inference would seem to be Jesus is not just the son of David, but also the son of God, understood as Yahweh's co-regent. We could surmise that the exclusive divinity of the God of Israel is maintained throughout Mark. Mark emphasized more than any other evangelist that there is one God. He stresses that more than any other of the authors. And yet, that does not seem to be done at the exclusion of Jesus. If we ask who is the Lord in the Gospel of Mark, the paradoxical answer is God and Jesus. So, to sum up on this point, if Mark intended to portray Jesus' baptism as an adoption, you might expect a bit more mention of his meritorious life that would warrant it, as you find in other adoptionist or exaltation authors. If a voice which calls Jesus son implies his adoption, then that means Jesus gets adopted an astounding three times. Third, Mark's Christology as a whole, I don't think, gels with an adoptionist Christology, since Jesus seems to participate in the lordship of Israel's God. In fact, I love the way Eugene Boring puts it. Eugene is a great New Testament scholar. I think he's a Texan too. Is that right, Dale? And he's a great Markan scholar. This is what Eugene Boring says. He says, "It is un-Markan to claim that Mark presents us with a human being, Jesus, who in the course of time is promoted to a higher ontological level. Whether this can be conceived as happening at his baptism or at his resurrection exaltation." There is a group called the Ebionites whose origin and texts and a lot about them is shrouded in mystery, everything about their group. They're thought to have been based on a chap called Ebion, but no one's really convinced that there was a guy by that name. Notwithstanding such caveats, many scholars remain fairly confident that this group held adoptionist beliefs. The idea that Jesus was a remarkable man, chosen by God to be his son and adopted at baptism. Now, while that statement I don't think is entirely false, I certainly don't think it's the best way to describe the Ebionites either. And one of the things that I find very striking is, generally speaking, Jewish authors were allergic to the idea of humans being deified. While Josephus and Philo were two Jewish authors immersed in the Hellenistic world who did their best to negotiate their way through it and affirm as much of Greek philosophy and Hellenistic culture as they could, both of them seem to have drawn a line at the idea of worshipping a deified figure. Josephus said that God has vetoed Israel from doing it. Philo said that deification was useful neither to God nor man. Also, adoption was generally not practiced in Judea and not normally used as a way of extending one's dynasty. If there's going to be an adoptionist Christology that's going to emerge, it's probably not going to be on Palestinian soil or in the Transjordan or amongst Jewish groups, but somewhere where deification is practiced and where adoption is also widely utilized as a way of extending one's family. I think it's more likely to be in Rome than in Palestine. And the other thing we can note, if you go through all the comments of patristic authors, they say some odd things about the Ebionites, but some of them point out that the Ebionites did not think Jesus was the Son of God in any sense. That's certainly the testimony of Tertullian. The one patristic author who seems to attribute views to them that are adoptionist is the author Epiphanius from the 5th century. He certainly does talk about them as ones who believe that Jesus was elevated or promoted to divine status. But even then, he doesn't use the language of adoption. He doesn't describe their views with the normal Son of God discourse about Jesus' unique filial relationship to God or about his messianic office. The other thing we've got to remember is Epiphanius is also one of our most unreliable authors about the Ebionites. He says a number of things that seems like he's just taking information from other sources and projecting it onto the Ebionites. There is a Gospel of the Ebionites, which presents a harmonized account of Jesus' baptism. But again, it's known only from Epiphanius, and we can't be really sure it was composed by the Ebionites. It was most likely composed in Greek and not in Aramaic. And yes, there is a moment in the scene of Jesus' baptism where you get this divine voice from heaven that says, "You are my son." But in contrast to a lot of the evangelists, this provides a full quotation of Psalm 2. The voice from heaven doesn't simply say, "You are my son." It says in full, "You are my son. Today I have begotten thee." And many have taken that as an indication, by quoting Psalm 2 in full, the Ebionites must have had an adoptionist Christology, believing at the moment of baptism, Jesus was begotten as the Son of God. The problem I have with that view is that Justin Martyr, when he narrates the baptism story of Jesus, he too quotes Psalm 2, not the short form, the long form. "You are my son, today I have begotten thee." But no one supposes that Justin Martyr is an adoptionist. If there is one belief that the church fathers seem to be fairly unanimous in attributing to the Ebionites, it is not that of adoptionism, but more along the lines of what Bart called a separation Christology, where an angel or the heavenly Christ descends upon Jesus at his baptism. And Alan Segal, a late scholar, argued that the Ebionites are probably more akin to a two powers belief, that there's two powers in heaven. One is Christ who comes on the man, Jesus. So there was a group called the Ebionites, but I think it's more likely they held to a possession Christology than an adoptionist one. That brings us to the last group, the Theodotians. Theodotus of Byzantium was a leather worker or cobbler who came to Rome in the late 2nd century, and he developed a bit of a following. You know, not bad for a leather maker, your own school of theology. According to Theodotus, Jesus was a mere man who was supremely virtuous. Thereafter, the Spirit, or Christ, descended upon him at baptism, enabling him to perform miracles. Hippolytus, who was a contemporary of Theodotus, he reports diversity among the Theodotians. Some didn't think Jesus was divine in any sense. Others believe he was made divine at his resurrection. And this is where I think Bart and I would be in broad agreement. Going on the sources we have here, even Theodotus cannot be properly called an adoptionist. Theodotus believed that Jesus was a mere man who received Christ or the Spirit at his baptism, and according to our earlier sources, he never claimed that Jesus was divine or became divine in any sense. He saw Jesus exclusively as a Spirit-empowered prophet and nothing more, as we know. But among the Theodotians, there were other views, a mixture of beliefs about Jesus as a mere man, a separation Christology, some real strange cray-cray speculations about Melchizedek as well. It was one group of the Theodotians who believed that Jesus was deified after his resurrection. Those, I submit, are the first clear, authentic, full Monty, bona fide adoptionists as far as the evidence goes. And that settles how, when Jesus was first adopted. Coming towards a conclusion, I do not think adoptionism is expressed in a text like Romans 1, 3 to 4. Not in the baptismal scene of the Gospel of Mark. Not really among the Ebionites, or there may be some loose connotations of it, but it wasn't their main show. Not by Theodotus, and it's really by one chapter of the Theodotians that we get this adoptionist Christology. What that means is the first and earliest Christology was not adoptionistic, as far as these sources tell us. Now, when I discuss ancient heresies or minor Christological beliefs with my students, I often tell them that sometimes the road less traveled is less traveled for a good reason. There might be some theological reasons why adoptionism was rejected as an inadequate account of Jesus. Because besides the matter of perhaps the general incongruity with the witness of the New Testament as a whole, there's a theological reason why adoptionism rejected. That is because adoptionism inevitably includes the belief that one can be self-justified before God. And it's at odds with the gospel of grace as the early church knew it. Justo Gonzalez argues that modern adoptionism denies the embodiment and the efficacy of grace in Jesus Christ, in favor of the view that Jesus merited divine favor by his good works. Jesus becomes the paragon, the example of the good man who's rewarded with divine honors. Viewed this way, adoptionism becomes the counterpart to the American myth that everybody can make it on the back of their own steam, on the sweat of their own hard labor. Everyone has a chance to get to the top. But Gonzalez writes, and he has in mind here largely the Hispanic church, he says, Jesus Christ must be more than first among the redeemed, more than local boy who makes good. He must also be the redeemer, the power from outside who breaks into our closed reality and breaks its structures of oppression. He must be more than the adopted son of God. He must be God adopting us as sons and daughters. And there, my good friends, endeth the lesson. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Michael. It's very lively, very interesting. Thank you very much. so I only have, 10 minutes. So, I think that was a very learned presentation, and I think Michael has ratcheted up the discussion to a higher scholarly level. I'm not sure how much I want to take him on a point by point, because I only have 9 minutes and 30 seconds, and interpretations of these passages are rather complicated. His overall point is that the earliest Christians were not adoptionists. You don't have that until the Theodosians in the second century. I fundamentally disagree with him on that. It's an unusual view that he sketched. I've never heard anybody maintain that before, but it's, you know, it needs to be taken seriously. I think it overlooks key evidence. He doesn't mention, for example, these early fragments that we have in the book of Acts, where Paul explicitly says in Acts chapter 13 that what God promised to the fathers, he's now provided to us, their children, by raising Jesus from the dead in fulfillment of the psalm, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." Or he says in Acts chapter 2:36 that by raising Jesus from the dead, God has made him both Lord and Christ. He does look to Romans chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. Michael does, and we fundamentally disagree about a number of things on that. That's the passage where Paul says that Christ was the son of David according to the flesh, but he was appointed to be son of God at his resurrection. He was appointed to be son of God at his resurrection. By raising him from God appointed him to be son of God by raising him from the dead. That certainly sounds like adoptionism, whether you have the words "in power" in there or not. Now, Michael says that it can't really be referring to somebody becoming the son of God, because in the Greco-Roman world, if somebody was adopted by God, they did not become the son. I'm not quite sure I understand the logic of that. If you're adopted by somebody, you become their son. That's what adoption is. And it doesn't work to say that if somebody's raised from the dead, they don't become the son of God, because Lazarus was raised from the dead. He wasn't the son of God. Or the two figures from Revelation, they're not thought of as the son of God. The difference is, when Lazarus is raised from the dead, the idea is he's going to die again. He's not made the son of God. He is resuscitated. He's brought back to life for a while. Jesus is raised from the dead never to die again. That's why he's made the Son of God. He's made a divine being, an immortal being, a being who won't die. I don't think it's right to say that Jesus was already the Son of God because he was descended from David. Probably every Jew on the planet today ultimately is descended from David. Just look at how genealogies work. And so Jesus was not the only human being on the earth who is descended from David. So does he want to say that everybody is the son of God? That would be fine with me, but I don't think that's really what he wants to argue. Paul makes a point that in terms of his earthly life, Jesus was the son of David, the Messiah. But in terms of his heavenly life, he became the son of God at the resurrection. Romans chapter 1, 3, and 4, just read it for yourself. What about Mark chapter 1, verse 11? So this is where the voice of the baptism says, "You are my son, in whom I am well pleased." And Michael wants to say this can't be God adopting Jesus to be the son, because then he's adopted three times in Mark's gospel, at the baptism, at the transfiguration, and at the crucifixion. Because on all three occasions, a voice says, "Son of God," in relationship to Jesus. It's an interesting point, but I think it overlooks something very, very important, which is at the baptism, the voice speaks in the second person to Jesus in Mark's gospel. The text in Mark's gospel at the baptism, the voice says, "You are my son, in whom I'm well pleased." That's the adoption formula when he becomes the Son of God. The voice of the transfiguration does not say, "You are my son." It does not adopt Jesus. It announces to the three disciples, Peter, James, and John, "This is my son." In other words, he's identifying that this is the one who's become the Son of God. And so too at the crucifixion. The Roman centurion who's crucified him says, "Truly this man was the Son of God." He's acknowledging that he's the Son of God. He's not making him the Son of God. It's a little unusual to argue that the Ebionites were not adoptionists. It doesn't matter for my case at all whether they were or not. It's true that some church fathers said that they had what I call a separationist Christology. Our earliest full representation of the Ebionites is actually in an author from the late second century named Irenaeus. Irenaeus and other church fathers who talk about the Ebionites call them adoptionists. Now, maybe Irenaeus didn't know what he was talking about, but he is our first heresy writer from early Christianity who gives a full list of a lot of different heresies and describes them. It may be that they weren't adoptions. I don't know. But I would absolutely not say that Jews were allergic to deification. That simply isn't true. In my book on how Jesus became God, I have a 37-page chapter, example after example after example, of Jews calling beings other than God Almighty God. Moses is called God by Philo. Philo's not allergic to deification. Philo not only thought Moses was God, he thought the Logos, the Word of God, was God. He calls the Logos the second God. Two gods. This is a Jewish author. You have this view that other beings can be gods in Scripture itself. Psalm 45. This is God speaking to the King of Israel, and he's, as Michael admits in his book, this is God speaking to the King of Israel, and he says, "Your throne, O God, is forever and ever." That's God speaking to the king. "Your throne, O God, is forever and ever." Of course, Solomon was supposed to be the Son of God. 2 Samuel verses 7, verses 11 through 14. "I will be a father to him, he will be a son to me." The kings of Israel were understood to be sons of God. Psalm 110, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet." Jews were not allergic at all to deification. There was an early Jewish heresy that, in fact, Michael mentioned that is studied by an important American scholar of Judaism named Alan Siegel, called the Two Powers in Heaven heresy. This is a heresy that was attacked by rabbis in early rabbinic literature. It was called Two Powers in Heaven because the understanding was somebody was sitting next to God on his throne. There is another enthroned figure next to God who is understood in Jewish circles to be a divine being. Christians ended up saying that Jesus is that one sitting next to God. They weren't coming up with something that no Jew had ever heard of. As Alan Siegel himself points out, this was a view that had been around for a long time that many rabbis were uncomfortable with, just as later Jews continued to be uncomfortable with the claim that Jesus was God. So at the end of the day, I'm not sure what Michael thinks about the question that we're talking about. The question is, How is it that Jesus came to be thought of as God? How did it happen? My view of this is the one that I laid out. I think that the early Christians did not think of Jesus as God during his lifetime. The evidence is pretty clear about that from the Gospels, the earliest Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Nobody calls him God in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They didn't think that. Well, they didn't think it then. When did they start to think it? At the resurrection. The resurrection is what made people start thinking that Jesus was God. And once they started thinking that Jesus was God, they started working out the implications of that. And as they thought more and more about it, their theology developed more and more until you get to the Council of Nicaea. So I don't know what Michael's alternative to that is. But maybe at some point he'll be able to tell us. Thank you very much.
Wow, that was great. I think we're going to sell a lot of your books this weekend. And I think we've got a lot of books here that ought to be bought this weekend, and we've got fabulous scholars. In fact, I said it in chapel earlier this week to a slightly larger crowd than this, but if I were a theological student or biblical studies student or someone interested in religion, and I had an opportunity to hear these speakers over 2 days, and I didn't take advantage of it, I'd be ashamed of myself. But I'm not trying to shame you into coming back tomorrow. I'm just sharing from the heart. Okay, we're going to have some Q&A, so let me explain to you how the Q&A will work. Okay, we do need some guidelines in orderly fashion for the Q&A. We want to get as many questions in as possible. So, number one, when you ask a question, make sure it is a real question. Okay, and ask yourself, are they paying me to be here? If we are not paying you to be here, that means, I won't say nobody, that means we are not paying you to lecture. And so make your questions genuine interrogatives. Now, you have heard that there is no such thing as a stupid question. That's not true. Okay, stupid questions are asked all the time. And with two guys who have the razor wit of these guys, don't ask a stupid question. So ask yourself, would this benefit everybody else who is here hearing this question answered? Not simply hearing this question asked. Then get to your question. Okay? Make it in a hurry. If you don't, I will play the bad cop. You will hear my voice going, do you have a question? Ask a question. Okay? You will. Okay, I could say something else. I'm not going to. Only one question. You don't get follow-up questions, no series of questions, unless one of the speakers asks you for a clarification. All right? All right, now, to keep it going, we're going to put some rules on the speakers. So if a question is asked to one speaker, he has up to 2 minutes to answer it. These guys are great lecturers. They know they're great lecturers. They love to lecture. Lecture in 2 minutes. And then if the other one who is not asked would like to add to it, he has up to 1 minute, but he's not required to. All right? If you ask it to both of them, we'll give them each 2 minutes. So, with that, that's how Robert's rules works. My name is Robert. I make the rules. Okay, so if you think that you more agree with Michael, come to this aisle. If you think that you more agree with Bart, we have to do that. It doesn't work out simply to say if you have a, we're going to alternate questions, because then you find, I mean, this is not 50-50. So if you think you more agree with Bart in that aisle, if you think you more agree with Michael in this aisle, and then we'll continue to ask the questions until we have to cut you off. And I know we're going to cut you off because we always do. But like I said, it will continue, and we will have some Q&A time tomorrow as well. So we'll start right here. Come on up, guys.
So, Dr. Ehrman, thank you very much for excellent presentation and response to Dr. Bird. Okay.
Them to be thanked with every question.
Okay.
But that's fine for the opening one. But
okay.
We're grateful they're here.
Thank you. In How Jesus Became God, you follow Crossan in rejecting the historicity of Jesus' burial. And after citing Crossan, you conclude that Roman practice was to allow the bodies of crucified people to decompose on the cross, and I have not run across any contrary indication in any ancient source. So my question is this. If you run across Josephus in the Jewish War, which Crossan cites, wherein Josephus writes that typically in Judea, Jews were careful to bury their crucifieds before sunset. Furthermore, are you aware that in the chapter of his work that you cite, Crossan notes the first century skeleton of a clearly crucified man? If you were aware of that ancient evidence, why do you state that you have not run across any contrary indication? If you were not aware of that evidence, how would you now account for it?
Can you turn this? Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, it's a good question. So let me explain. Let me explain what's going on in my book. When I earlier said that the empty tomb would not lead anybody to faith, what I didn't say is that I don't think there is an empty tomb. It's a rather long, complicated argument that I'm not going to be able to do in 1 minute and 33 seconds. But the reality is that every Roman and Greek source that talks about crucifixion, that mentions the fact, says that the bodies were left on the cross. They were left on the cross in order to allow the body to decompose, because that was part of the punishment. If you think that you can cross the power of Rome, this is what will happen to you. You'll be tortured to death, and you'll be left on the cross to rot. And that's what Romans did. I am familiar with all of the passages in Josephus and in other texts. When I said that there's no contrary evidence, I was saying that in Greek and Roman sources, there's absolutely no evidence to the contrary. Josephus gives two instances of people coming off a cross, but neither in those two instances, the people were not dead. Romans did not care about Jewish law in Palestine or anywhere else. They were Romans. They didn't follow Jewish law. In Jewish law, if Jews had crucified people, they'd have to take them off the cross. If you want to see my fuller explanation, I actually deal with this passage of Josephus, go to my blog, because I give about a two-week answer to these questions as they were raised by Craig Evans. I'm out of time.
Next question. Dr. Ehrman, I've heard you say before that we can't reliably say that the apostles have died for their faith, like historically. Is that because there's no documentation, or the documentation was from a later date, or because it was based on tradition? And does that apply to Peter or Paul?
Thank you. So the question is, do we know how people died? The reason I've made this comment before is all of you have probably heard that the disciples would not lie about the resurrection because all of them were martyred for believing in the resurrection. That is commonly stated. And my view is we don't know how the disciples died. We don't know. How would we know? You think, well, there must be records, right? Wrong. So if you read through the book of Acts, which is about the apostles, most of the apostles have no role at all to play. There are a couple of martyrdoms. James is killed. Stephen is killed. Stephen, of course, wasn't one of the 12. Well, how are the others killed? We don't know. We don't start getting texts that talk about the death of the disciples until the late second century. These texts are recognized by everybody as being legendary. If somebody says to you that the apostles all died for their faith in the resurrection, ask them what their source of information is, because they don't have a source of information. They say that because that's what they heard. And if you ask the person they heard it from what their source of information is, they won't have a source of information. We do have later accounts. We have accounts of Peter and Paul being martyred. We don't have actual stories of them being martyred until the late 2nd century. We do have a reference to Peter and Paul being killed, probably in Rome, in the book of 1 Clement from the year 96 or so CE. But he doesn't tell us why they were martyred. Clearly they believed in the resurrection, and clearly they got martyred, so I assume it has something to do with that. The other disciples we simply don't know about because we have no records.
Dr. Ehrman, is it correct to say that you believe Jesus' self-claims of divinity in the Gospel of John are merely late and false inventions? And if so, are there any passages in the Gospels you consider to be factual? And what criteria do you use in deciding what is factual and what isn't?
Good, thank you. In the Gospel of John, Jesus repeatedly makes divine claims for himself, claims found only in the Gospel of John. Jesus says, before Abraham was, I am. Claiming the name of God for himself. When he says, and the Jews know what he's saying because they take up stones to stone him to death. John, that's John 8:58. John 10:30, I and the Father are one. Once more, the Jews break out the stones. So Jesus tells his disciples that if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. So Jesus is claiming to be a divine being in the Gospel of John. There is no doubt about that. So the question is, do I think that those are late and legendary? And the answer is yes. I don't think that the historical Jesus went around saying, I'm God, as Michael himself pointed out earlier. That's not what Jesus went around saying, that I'm God. The Gospel of John is portraying Jesus as a divine being, and he's having Jesus call himself a divine being. But that doesn't mean that historically that actually happened. Here's my view of it. If Jesus went around calling himself God, the way John portrays, that would be the most important thing to know about him, wouldn't it? I mean, what would be more important to know? That this man is calling himself God. That would be fundamentally important. If that's the case, why did Matthew, Mark, and Luke neglect to mention it? They just forgot to bring up that part, that he's calling himself God? How's that possible? It's a stunning silence. Well, if I don't think those passages in John are reliable historically, do I think anything's reliable? Yes, of course. There's a lot of things in the Gospels, even the Gospel of John, that's reliable. And scholars use historical criteria to decide what is reliable. I absolutely think there's historical material in the Gospels, but I think among that material, it's not Jesus' claims to divinity.
I will try to chime in just to remind people I exist. I think the Gospel of John is a mixture of memory, midrash, and mysticism. That sounds a bit complex. I think there is a historical tradition in John, but it's been pushed through a very thick interpretive layer. So what we get in the Gospel of John, even on the lips of Jesus, is not just the words of Jesus, not just the voice of Jesus, but sometimes the impression that Jesus made on his earliest followers that are incorporated into the narrative. So I think there is a historical tradition in John. There are some who say that John is historically worthless. I wouldn't go that far. But John is different to the synoptics. The way I describe the Gospel of John, imagine you've got, it's like going from New York peak hour traffic to Mardi Gras traffic. Okay, it's just very, very different what is going on.
This question is for both of you. So if you give a list of the Christologies that were on offer in the early church, and you gave a list of modalism, adoptionism, separationism, and so on, do you both agree that one thing that didn't exist anywhere in the early church would be a Christ mythicist view where there is no human Jesus whatsoever, but there's some celestial or heavenly Jesus or something that we worship, and there's a modern school that thinks that that was a group that had a Christology like that?
Okay, I'll go first. If you mean some sort of early Jesus myth a la mythicist view, no. when you get into some of the Gnostic and esoteric literature, you do find something kind of like Jesus as being a cosmic aeon or something that's taken on some sort of human form of such, but maybe not in the precise sense in which you're looking for.
Yeah, so I not only get, an unkind reception from certain fundamentalists, I also get an unkind reception from certain mythicists who get really upset with me. Atheists and agnostics who otherwise think they should like me don't like me at all. And it's because I think Jesus existed. Right. So can I add on that?
Can I add on that?
Yeah.
Okay. Even if Jesus existed, even if the early church had a high Christology, you can still be an atheist. But you can't be a stupid atheist. It's going to be all right. Yeah. I want to give you pastoral assurance.
Right. Okay. So I wrote a book called Did Jesus Exist? Which argues that, yes, Jesus did exist. Were there any early Christians who thought that Jesus did not exist? No. It's a completely modern invention. It's a kind of a scary modern invention. You all might not be familiar with this. There's a very loud voice on the internet now arguing that the historical Jesus is a myth, that he didn't exist. And I think it's an awful view. I do think it's a stupid view. But there are people who subscribe to it.
You said that Jews had no problem with deifying people, referring to them as being, you know, at the side of God and so forth. But in Mark 14:61 through 64, you have the high priest asking him, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed?" And he says, "I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven." Now, at no point does Christ say, "I am God," obviously, as you said earlier, but yet they all then immediately said, "We don't need any more proof. He's just blasphemed. We should kill him." So if the Jews were to the point of wanting to kill Jesus for saying something like that, how are you saying also that they had no problem with people being deified otherwise?
Yeah, thank you. I'm not saying that every Jew was happy with every person who is thought to be God. In Mark's gospel, the understanding is that the Caiaphas and the Jewish council is upset that Jesus is apparently making some kind of divine claim for himself. That doesn't mean that they excluded everybody from making a divine claim for himself. This is talking about Jesus here. Moreover, Caiaphas and the council are not representative of all Jews. There is no question that Jews thought that human beings could become divine. Enoch is worshipped as a divine being. Enoch is worshipped as a divine being in the book of 1 Enoch. Philo calls Moses God. There are other instances of this in Jewish history. As I said, I've got 37 pages to devote, and I'm just scratching the surface. Yeah. So it's absolutely right that the council is upset with Jesus because they think he's making a divine claim, but that doesn't mean that Jews were always afraid of deifying a human being.
I'll just add on that quickly. There's no question that there was a belief that certain figures, like Enoch, had been elevated to a certain status, had been assumed into heaven. The main issue, they didn't want that to transgress the orbit of Yahweh's authority or receive the worship, the monolatry, the worship that was exclusively meant to belong to the one God. My favorite story of Jews being allergic to divine or worship a human being is that the Jews in Pella tore down images of Caligula. And that was the event that led Caligula to try to put a statue of himself in the Holy of Holies. If the Jews don't want to worship my image, then I'll stick my image in their very temple. That, to me, shows a real steep allergy to the worship of human figures. May not be shared by everyone in the same intensity, but I think there is a slightly more crisper line going on there.
Right. My question for Dr. Bird. Dr. Ehrman brought up Acts 13, I think it's 32 through 34, yep. somewhere around there a couple of times, and I assume you don't have an adoptionist interpretation of that passage, so in 2 minutes, could you give us the non-adoptionist interpretation of that?
Yeah, I'll say, in hindsight, I probably should have said something about those texts. In Acts 2, it never mentions Jesus becoming a son, so it's not an adoptionist. If you're not made a son, you can't get adopted. Yes, it does have an exaltation that the man, Jesus, is elevated to this great status, but that does not mean that's the only thing they believed. It doesn't mean that it cannot be married to pre-existence or something else. The other thing in Acts 2, if you read the wider context, yes, there's things like pre-existence going on. All sorts of things are being said about Jesus. And in fact, the main emphasis is not the status reversal of Jesus, but rather it's the epistemology. It's that Israel needs to know that the man whom they crucified, God has made Lord and Messiah. In other words, the main point is God has reversed the verdict that the Judean leaders made about Jesus. Now, when you get to Acts 13, yes, you have this same issue of Jesus' change in status from human Messiah, who is a son of God, into this divine status, but a full-length citation of Psalm 2 does not an adoption make, because you can find similar language in Justin Martyr and elsewhere where it's not used in an adoptionist fashion.
Yeah, I think the key is the wording in that Acts 13 passage. Paul says that the promises were fulfilled, God fulfilled the promises. By raising him from the dead, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. So it is the point in that speech where he becomes the son of God. Whether you want to call that adoptionism or not doesn't really matter to me. If you want to call it like Michael as exaltation, that's fine. If a being is exalted, that means they're raised to a higher level. They can't be already at that high level prior to their exaltation. Otherwise, they're not being exalted. And so that's how I understand the earliest Christology, is that Jesus was put to a higher level. I'm not saying that that's a right Christology. I'm not saying it's a Christology people ought to believe. I'm saying that was the original understanding of the Christians that later developed into other Christological views.
Hi, my question actually segues off of his. One of the words that keeps coming up is the begotten, especially in that passage.
Begotten.
The phrase begotten. So begotten. I was wondering about adoption in Judaism and the terminology begotten. Is there any precedence in any other texts or any other sources that we see specifically begotten in the other language tied to adoption within the Jewish tradition?
Not in the Jewish tradition, but in the Greco-Roman tradition, the first person to talk about the gods being begotten and immutable is Plutarch.
Thank you.
It's true, Bart.
So begotten language is, that's a great question. So begotten is a language for a male who brings forth a child. So obviously the male doesn't become pregnant, but the male makes the female pregnant. She brings forth. So it's a tricky thing with God, because if God's a male, how does he give birth? But that's the idea, that he gives birth. So there are lots of. Were you asking the Jewish tradition specifically? Yeah, yeah.
Yes, in the Jewish tradition, because the earlier synoptic gospels would have been set mainly in a Jewish tradition.
Yeah, yeah. What I would argue is that the synoptic gospels are influenced not only by Jewish traditions, but also by Greek and Roman traditions. I mean, the gospels are written in Greek, for example. You know, they're not written in Aramaic, the language of Palestine. They're written in Greek. And in Greek and Roman circles, there was a very common idea that a god could bring forth a divine human. And so in Greek and Roman mythology, for example, sometimes a god will make a woman pregnant and the child will be both human and divine. That's where Hercules comes from. Hercules is a divine man because Jupiter gets the woman pregnant and her child then is the son. And so you think, well, yeah, you wouldn't find that in Jewish circles. Yeah, except you do. In Genesis chapter 6, for example, where the sons of God looked upon the daughters of men and saw that they were beautiful, they came down and cohabited with them, and their offspring were these giants who were roaming the earth. This is borrowing into that view that you have, here you have heavenly beings who make an earthly beings pregnant. And so you don't have anything quite like the begotten language in the first century that I know about, but it certainly stands in both the Greek and Roman and Jewish traditions at some point.
Michael Papard's got a very good discussion of begotten language in the early church in his book, The Son of God in the Roman World. I recommend you read that.
Yes, Dr. Ehrman, a question. Do you believe that Jesus is perfect God, perfect man, all the way God, all the way man, the hypostatic union of Christ? Do you believe that he died for all of your sins on the cross and all of our sins? It was efficacious. It paid for our sins, made us just. And then that he rose from the dead, that went for each and every one of us, that precious free gift of everlasting resurrection life. He took care of our death problem with that. He took care of our sin problem when he died on the cross. His blood washed away. Do you believe that? And if you don't believe all that, what? Maybe you believe some of it. Elaborate, please. Thank you.
No, I don't believe any of it. I did. When I was in high school, when I was a 15-year-old, I accepted Christ as my Lord and Savior and committed my life to him. After high school, I went to Moody Bible Institute, which was at the time was a bastion of fundamentalist Christianity, and I was very rigorously involved with my faith. Wanted to devote my life to Christ and His kingdom, and was completely committed to the Bible as the inerrant revelation of God. Had a personal relationship with Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And was like that for years. As I studied the Bible more, I began to realize, reading it in the original Greek and in the original Hebrew, that in fact it simply wasn't an inerrant revelation. I wanted to believe it was, but I started finding discrepancies. I found out how people resolve these discrepancies. I got to a point where I just realized some of these cannot be reconciled. This is just a contradiction. And I had to decide, am I going to go where I think the truth is leading me, or am I going to stay where I feel more comfortable? And I decided that I really had to go where I thought the truth was leading me. I ended up becoming a liberal Christian. I was still a faithful Christian. I was a pastor of a Baptist church for a year. I was still actively involved in ministry. Eventually, the reason I left Christianity altogether is unrelated to my scholarship. It's because I simply no longer could believe that there was a God who is active in a world where there's just so much pain, misery, and suffering, where a child, an innocent child, starves to death every 5 seconds. I realized I just don't believe it anymore, and so I became an agnostic about 20 years ago. So, no, I don't believe any of that.
I became a Christian about 20 years ago. I don't know if I'd quite put it in the way the gentleman put it, but I grew up in a very non-Christian background. Growing up, everything I knew about Christianity, I learned from Ned Flanders. Ned Flanders was the only pastor I ever knew. And I thought all Christians were just moralizing geriatrics. And then I actually met some, and they introduced me to the good news of Jesus. And I just prayed one night to receive Christ, and that was the moment I left the matrix. I could go on to talk about things, but people ask me not often why I became a Christian, but I have to tell them why I'm still a Christian, and this for one simple reason. I believe in the utter worshipability of Jesus. That's all I have to say on that.
All right. We are going to have one more question, but there will be more Q&A tomorrow, and we'll have a panel discussion with all six of our speakers, and so I really encourage you to come back, and I will put you people in the front of the line if you'll come back tomorrow for the Q&A session. Okay. So, but I'm not shaming you into coming back. Okay, this final question.
Yeah. My question is about the charge of blasphemy in Mark, in particular in Mark 14, and it's for Dr. Ehrman, but I'd like to hear what both of you think. So I thought I heard you saying that Jesus doesn't claim to be divine in the earlier Gospels, in particular in the Gospel of Mark, and yet we were just looking at the account of the trial before Caiaphas, where Caiaphas asked him, are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed? He says, I am, and you'll see the Son of Man, see the right hand of power, and come in the clouds of glory. And then they charge him with blasphemy. He's quoting there Psalm 110 and Daniel 7. So my question is, I just want to be clear. Is Jesus claiming to be divine there? If he's not, then why do they charge him with blasphemy in the context of a question about his identity? Yeah. And second, why does he quote Psalm 110 in Mark? I'm sorry, well, this is part of the same question because it ties into preexistence. In Mark 12 and Mark 14, he quotes Psalm 110, which is the one psalm in the Old Testament that says, before the day star, I have begotten you. So isn't implicit preexistence there? So two questions in one, I hope. Sorry. My main question is he making a divine claim there? And if not, why the blasphemy charge?
Well, no, it's a complicated question. And it really would take, I mean, for a detailed exegesis, it obviously take a very long time to do. I think it's one of the more confusing passages in the Gospel of Mark, because technically speaking, Jesus does not commit a blasphemy. The chief priest asked him, are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed? And Jesus says, I am. Now, that's not a blasphemy. He's saying, yes, I am the Messiah. There's no blasphemy claiming to be the Messiah. Messiah is just the future king of Israel. And so that's not a blasphemy. And then he says, you will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven. So that's not a blasphemy. That's just referring to Daniel, that you're going to see what Daniel predicted in Daniel chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. But then they cry out, blasphemy. So what's the blasphemy? So there are a number of theories about this. One theory that I don't accept is that when Jesus says, I am, he's claiming the divine name for himself. I don't think so, because the word I am simply means yes. Are you the Messiah? Yes. I am the Messiah. It's not claiming the divine name. It's just how you say yes. So then if that's not the blasphemy, what is the blasphemy? I think you have to understand that for Mark himself, the author of this gospel, Jesus is the Son of Man. Jesus is coming back in glory. Jesus has been exalted to the right hand of God, and he's coming back as the judge of the earth. It's not that some anonymous Son of Man is coming. Jesus is coming. Mark thinks that's what Jesus, Mark thinks that's what Jesus is. So when Jesus says, you will see the Son of Man, Mark requires you to think Jesus is the Son of Man. The high priest knows that he thinks that, and so the high priest thinks he's claiming to be the Son of Man, and so he calls out blasphemy. So is it a divine claim? Well, yeah, kind of. I mean, it is. Yeah, kind of. But it's not like Jesus saying, I and the Father are one. Sorry, I'm out of time. Pardon me?
It's the invention of Mark.
Yes, of course it's the invention of Mark. It's the invention of Mark. I mean, that's, yeah. Yeah, it's not this. Look, we don't know. There's no way we know what happened at the trial of Jesus before Caiaphas. This is Mark's account. So I'm talking about the historical Jesus. We don't know what happened at the trial before Caiaphas. How would we know that? Jesus would have known. I'm stopping now.
All right, let's go, Mahan. Okay, keep your seats unless you're paid to be here. Our president is going to, and my assistant Andrew are going to be leading our speakers to the cafeteria for you. And you will find them in the cafeteria, and you will find these books in the cafeteria. And, man, you ought to buy these books. And not only buy them, you ought to read them. I mean, there's a difference between having them and reading them. Okay, let me just Let me close with a word of prayer, but also with a word of thanks. I cannot thank you enough for being here this evening. I mean that seriously to each and every person who came. Now, NOBTS students, they're free, unless they procrastinate so long that they pass the point at which free becomes $5. But it's good to have them. And they pay through the nose for other things around here. And general public people, university students who have come with groups, I am grateful for each and every one of you. And I wish I had the time to just shake hands with each and every one of you and thank you personally. And I'm open to shaking hands with a lot of you. But anyway, we do have a great reception. And we have a great program tomorrow, and this really is a fabulous group of scholars that we've brought together, and I hope you appreciate that, even if you don't appreciate me. So let's pray, and we'll be dismissed. Father, we thank you for a great evening. We thank you that these are important issues and that the great minds have spent careers working in this area. We thank you that we can talk to each other without being angry and fussing and fighting. And that we can do more than generate heat. We generate light. And we pray that we would actually know the truth, embrace the truth, and live it. In Jesus' name, amen.